My respected elders, my brothers and sisters, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. I hope everybody had a good Eid. And I also hope by now that you've digested your biryanis, your chicken tikkas, your pakoras and your samosas. The last time I was in Liverpool, mashallah, after the talk, the brothers shared their biryanis and their chicken tikkas with me. However, I must mention, it was my brothers that were doing the eating. I, on the other hand, was receiving a bombardment of questions, all seem to be relating to the jinn, while my brothers were enjoying themselves eating. Obviously these brothers, they were interested, keen, you can say curious about the jinn. Mind you, they were not the only ones. Wherever you seem to go, you find people talking about jinns, talking about some house which may have a jinn inside it, or talking about some human being which might be possessed by a jinn. People love talking about things like this. People love talking about things which are of extraordinary nature. Things which may be irrelevant. Things which will have no effect on his iman or on his daily life as a practicing Muslim. People just love talking about strange things. And it seems as if this is human nature. Talk about UFOs, talk about aliens, talk about dinosaurs and things of this nature, and people will listen to you for hours without even blinking. But on the other hand, talk about tafsir, talk about issues relating to fiqh, Islamic jurisprudence. 2 minutes into the talk and you will find people yawning. You will find people fidgeting, moving and leaving. This, unfortunately, is the state of the Ummah. So anyway, today, to save myself, keep on answering the same questions time after time, I've decided to talk about the jinn and pass an hour relating stories to you. So you can go home and relate these stories to your brothers, to your sisters, and to your friends and your mothers and fathers. Ibn Aqil relates in Al-Funun, كَانَ عِنْدَنَا دَارٌ كُلَّمَا سَكَنَهَا نَاسٌ أَصْبَحُوا مَوْتًا. It is that we had a house, and every time somebody lived inside his house, next morning this guy is a goner, he's already reached the heavens. He's died. It is on one occasion what happened was a man came from Maghrib. He looked at the house. He was pleased with it. And he took it on rent. Next morning, and this guy is still walking and talking, this guy is still alive. Everybody is astonished, the neighbors surprised. How come this guy is still alive? He still made it. Not only did he make it, he stayed in that house for a period of time, and only then did he move. When he moved, the neighbors, the locals asked him. He said, on the first night, I prayed Salatul Isha and I began to recite the Quran. I began to recite the Quran when all of a sudden a young man came out of the well. He greeted me with salam. I was terrified. A young guy coming out of the well? He said to me, don't be worried. علمني شيئا من القرآن. All I want you to do is teach me some Quran. I began to teach him the Quran. And then asked him, كهذه الدار كيف حديثها? What's the score with this house? Why is everybody afraid to live inside this house? How come everybody that used to live in here used to wake up dead? He replied, نحن جن المسلمون نقرأ ونصلي وهذه الدار ما يكثر بها إلا الفساق. That we are Muslim jinn. We pray the Quran and we also pray. A majority of the time, this house was rented by fasiqeen, fusaq, sinners. They would spend their time taking intoxicants and alcohol. And we dislike this. Thus, we would strangle them. I said to him, okay, I'm scared of you when you come during the night. I'd be grateful if you can come during the day. He says thereafter, this young man would come out of the well during the day. And I would teach him the Quran. And one day as I was teaching him the Quran, one of these guys that do ta'weez was on the street calling out, أرقى من الدبيب ومن العين ومن الجن. But I do ta'weez from everything, from creepy crawlies and from the evil eye and even from the jinn. The jinn asked, what's this? I remarked that this is just one of these guys that do ta'weez. I brought this guy inside, and to my surprise, the jinn had turned into a snake and was on the roof. This guy began to recite something, and the jinn slowly descended till it fell in the middle of the room. He stood up to take it and put it inside his basket. I gave him a dinar instead, and he left. The snake shook, and out came the jinn, all weak and pale, and had lost a lot of weight. I asked him, what's the score? How come all of a sudden he had become weak and pale? He replied, قتلني هذا بهذه الأسماء وما أظنني أفلح. Now this Taoist guy has killed me with the words that he's recited. And I don't think I will make it alive tonight. If you hear a scream inside the well tonight, then leave. He says, that very night, I was informed that this jinn is no more, he has passed away. Thus I left. Ibn Aqil says that nobody ever lived in this house ever again. It gets better. Shah Waliullah Muhaddis Dahlami was a great Muhaddis of his time, a master of hadith. His brother Shah Ahlullah was once inside the masjid reciting the Quran when a snake passed. He didn't think much of the snake, and he killed the snake. After a very short time, two men entered the masjid and said to Shah Sahib, the king is calling you. Shah Sahib went with. Now, when they left the town, they began to head towards the jungle. Now Shah Sahib got worried and sent something fishy and asked, where's the king? They replied, the king's nearby. Shah Sahib went with thinking that the king probably went hunting in the jungle and he's probably camping there. Some masalas probably cropped up and the king probably needs the answer to this masala. So without further question, Shah Sahib went with them into the jungle. When they entered the jungle, Shah Sahib saw a huge gathering. An old man sitting on the throne. Cases are being presented before him. And this old man is solving these cases one by one. This in reality was a jinn king. And this was his palace. Shah Sahib joined the gathering and sat to one side. After a short while, A man came and claimed that Shatab has killed his son without any reason whatsoever. And thus he wants the law of Qisas to be applied to Shatab. A nafs for bin nafs, a life for a life. Shatab stunned, gobsmacked, and denied any knowledge of this. However, when Shatab is informed that the snake that he killed was in reality a baby jinn, Shatab acknowledged and remained quiet. Now the law of Qisas, the death penalty, was on the verge of being announced. When an old man from amongst that very gathering, from amongst those sitting in the circle, who had seen Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and embraced